Jacques, thank you so much for inviting me to your home.
Thanks so much for coming. We got so much information during our trip. I thought it would be nice to go over some of the interesting pieces we had to cut out.
Absolutely. A debrief would be great. You know, there was just so much good stuff. If we had to include everything, the episode would be an hour long.
This is meant to be a supplement to the main episode in Adventures in Genomics.
So if you haven't checked out our main episode, please be sure to check that out first. The link will be in the description below.
Now that we're back from Christina Warner's lab at the University of Oklahoma, what was the highlight for you?
You know, I loved everything about it, but what really stuck out in my mind was the picture of the galaxy that she showed.
It is amazing. When you see those microbes, it really does look like a galaxy. You almost feel like you could fly through it.
And to think that the number of microbes in and on our body exceeds the number of stars in over 300 galaxies.
Yeah, on those pictures, every point of light is a microbe. And you feel like you can reach out and touch them. And then you realize these things are thousands of years old.
It's almost like time traveling.
It really is. And who knows where this journey is going to lead. But one thing you can be sure of is it's going to be a fascinating journey. I love this electron microscope image of the calculus. It shows a huge amount of information.
Absolutely. You can really see how the calculus was formed in layers over the life of the individual.
You know, the exact mechanism of calculus deposition is still unknown, but we do know that the process is appositional. That means that there are alternating bands of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria.
And you can see the layers in this image. If you look closely, you can see individual filamentous bacteria oriented perpendicular to the tooth surface. So why doesn't the DNA deteriorate when the bacteria die?
That's a really good question. As the calcium phosphate in the saliva starts to precipitate, it builds up crystals that prohibit nutrients from going from the outside of the biofilm to the inside. And then the bacteria in the inside, they start starving and they start to die. Their iron pumps stop working and they start to calcify then from the inside out.
So it's a two-step process. I mean, the bacteria calcify from the inside out and then from the outside in.
That's exactly right. This dual process is very important for DNA preservation because the enzymes don't have time to break down the DNA. And also the mineral that actually forms is hydroxyapatite, which is excellent for binding the DNA and for protecting it.
Absolutely. And you know, we were focusing on the microbes, but the calculus also captures microfossils, like bits of food.
You know, they are fascinating because they actually tell you how the person lived.
Here we have microcharcoal from smoke or burnt material and a birch pollen grain. When you see it, you can imagine and almost smell the fire and the birch forest.
It is very evocative. Plant and animal materials are very hard to classify visually. And here again, they're starting to use sequencing to identify genetic sequences consistent with specific foods like pork, wheat, and sheep.
You know, just imagine getting all this information from a tiny little piece of calculus. It's truly adding a whole new dimension to this ancient field of paleontology. Jacques, I was amazed at how calculus can act as a capsule to preserve the DNA.
You know, Christina mentioned that both bones and teeth are porous, and that the microbes can use those channels to infiltrate and decompose the bone after death.
You know, those channels are needed to heal and grow bones, and bone is constantly being remodeled, so even dense bones need a means of perfusion.
Well, you know, calculus is different. Even though it's the same material as bones and teeth, and it's formed from calcium phosphate, it's a precipitate, and it actually encapsulates whatever is in the dental plaque at that time.
So there's no channels, and it's not porous.
That's absolutely right. And another important point, calcium phosphate is in the form of hydroxyapatite, and that actually binds the DNA, which may actually help to preserve it.
So if the DNA is bound to a substrate, it will be protected from degradation by nucleases.
You know, that's right. And interestingly enough, when in the old time, when I was still working in the lab, Hydroxyapatite was pretty commonly used to on columns to purify the DNA.
You know, calculus also forms during your lifetime, so the microbes are encapsulated while they're still alive and fresh.
Yeah, it skips the whole pesky death and decay process. So, but calcification actually is a really complex process, and it's part of the reason why the material is so well preserved. And we'll cover that much more in another section.
Jacques, this is by far one of my most favorite images. You can just see all the microbes in the calculus.
They used Hoechst's stain to show the abundant in situ double-stranded DNA in decalcified calculus.
Now, when you compare the modern and thousand-year-old ancient DNA slides, you can just see how remarkable the preservation is.
Every pinpoint is an individual microbe, but if you look really closely, and it is most apparent on the modern DNA, you see some DNA outside the cells.
So, is that extracellular DNA?
That's exactly right. That is DNA from the microbes. It is part of the three-dimensional scaffolds the cell need to locate and then to orientate themselves.
So, the matrix is also thought to act as a nucleation point to start the calcium phosphate crystal formation.
Yes, and of course the calcium phosphate crystals are the hydroxyapatite that binds the DNA. The microbes need the matrix, and that is one of the reasons so few microbes can usually be cultured in the lab. And now next generation sequencing is making a really big difference in the studying of dental microbes.
Jacques, the clean rooms were very impressive, and it is one of the most advanced laboratories in the country.
There's a lot more to it than you see in the video. When the people are not working in the laboratories, strong UV lamps kill the microbes and they destroy the DNA.
You know, I remember we actually had to arrange our schedule around the lab protocols.
That's true. The movement between the labs is tightly controlled.
Yes, and you know, there are several layers, each getting progressively cleaner.
You know, to go into the cleanest labs would have taken a lot more precautions than the ones we took.
You do not want to contaminate the ancient samples with our modern DNA.
It's not just our DNA. Microbial contamination is a huge problem. The polymerases that are used for the amplification process are derived from microbes, and they would preferentially amplify microbial DNA to the exclusion of human sequences.
We know how important it is to contain sample contamination, but we will cover that in another section.
The DNA fragment size was an interesting story to me. The short fragment size used to be a huge problem with PCR and Sanger sequencing. Remember, PCR will preferentially amplify shorter pieces, so that actually makes the problem worse.
You know, for next-gen sequencing, it actually makes it easier because they do not have to do the fragmentation step when they're doing library prep.
You know, it's one of those applications that was just not possible before next-gen sequencing.
You know, and Christina mentioned that they typically see fragments of about 50 to 90 bases long, depending on how well-preserved a sample is.
You know, with very old samples, say in the order of hundreds of thousands of years, the size can drop down to 25 bases.
And that's still long enough to get, you know, useful information.
Yeah, and apparently the oldest authentic ancient DNA that has ever been studied is about 700,000 years old. And it was recovered from a horse in the permafrost.
You know, I really wonder how long that record will stand.
Probably not very long, the way things are going.
So the samples are heavily contaminated when they enter the lab.
Freshly dug up? Well, the good news is that calculus does not have natural channels and pores, so external bacteria cannot penetrate it, especially once it's calcified in your mouth.
The thought still just creeps me out. But it does mean that they only need to clean the surface to remove environmental contaminants.
Exactly. They just soak it in EDTA to decalcify the outer layer, and then they agitate it vigorously to shake off dirt and environmental contaminants.
So what they do is they save the wash solution as a control, so they can compare the sample with the contamination.
Yes. Some microbes can be used as controls, because, for example, Acinetobacteria, it's very common in the soil. but it's very rare in the calculus. So if you see acidobacteria, you know that you've got a contamination problem.
Absolutely. And as the technology is getting increasingly sensitive, it is crucial to have good experimental designs and controls.
The simplicity of the sample prep really surprised me. I expected they would be grinding the samples under liquid nitrogen or something equally heroic.
I agree, I was actually expecting the same. But you know, Christina did mention that they tried many, many methods until they found one that actually worked.
They list the results from their various methods in their Nature Genetics paper from 2014. That paper has 100 pages of supplemental materials. In the end, it turns out, the most successful was also the simplest. They simply tumble the calculus in EDTA, and then they add a little bit of proteinase K.
And then they use the silicon columns for cleanup, and from there, standard Illumina library prep and sequencing.
Their methods are very well described in the paper I mentioned earlier. Tenorella forsythia is a gram-negative member of the bacterioidetes. It's also associated with advanced periodontal disease and has been reported in atherosclerotic lesions. It is pretty amazing that they were actually able to sequence this in 30-fold coverage.
You know, just because the DNA was there, it doesn't mean that the microbe was alive and active.
That is a very good point. In a fresh sample, you could simply sequence the RNA and know if it's alive.
And see what it was doing.
Of course. In this case, they had to use mass spec, and they identified peptides belonging to 10 forsythia proteins.
That would confirm that it was alive and making proteins at one stage. Now, it is very powerful when you can combine sequencing with such technology such as mass spec.
When you combine the two, you actually get a really great insight into some of these ancient tissues.
Jacques, when you see the two, it is just so strange to see that massive chunk of calculus.
It's not intuitive at all, and you rarely see it because it's usually cleaned off by your dentist. So if you see modern examples of heavy calculus in a textbook, you can only be glad that they actually do that.
You know, in the museum collections, the calculus is also scraped off, so anthropologists can see the characteristics of the teeth.
Now we know that what they throw away is arguably the most interesting part of the sample.
You know, and this sample was 4,000 years old, and it makes you wonder what dental hygiene was like back then.
It depends a bit on the location. You know, in some traditions, they use sticks or toothpicks and so on. Whole books have been written on this subject. And there's some evidence, actually, that Neanderthals used toothpicks.
You know, maybe this work will help shed some light on that subject as well.
We just never know what you'll discover next.